The Philippines' National Security Adviser has slammed calls for student boycotts in protest of the projected election victory of Bongbong Marcos. Hermogenes Esperon Jr. described the academic walkout as dangerous for the youth, saying these would make schools vulnerable to communist recruitment. Today, we talked to some of the student leaders behind this movement. We are joined by Jonas Abadilla, the chairperson of the University of the Philippines Diliman University Student Council, and Paaralang, the president of the Ateneo Sanggunian. Good morning, Jonas, Kara. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning, Ms. Nikki. Thank you for having us for this interview for this morning.
All right. First off, Jonas, can you tell us about the walkout protests by various universities? These are in protest of a projected election win for Marcos, right? Under whose father we know student activists were arrested, tortured, and killed.
Yes, this is a protest against electoral fraud by the Commission on Elections. As we all know, the Commission on Elections has handled the elections too poorly. No, so we are rejecting also the Marcos Duterte incoming administration, and this is the role of the students against these kinds of rampant electoral fraud. And also the threat of the return of the martial law and the return of the dictatorship in our dictatorship and tyranny in our country. And we also believe as students, no decent and pro-people plan for education under Marcos regime, and education under Marcos Duterte will be senseless. And we can also see no platforms from these tandem. And also, just to give you a background, different universities from the UAEP, from the from other universities across Manila, not only in Manila but also from Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao have demonstrated different protests against this electoral fraud that is happening right now. So we are calling also the COMELEC to have further investigation for these matters.
Mm-hmm. And Kara, what about you? Our National Security Advisor Hermogenes Esperon is blaming school administrations for these student-initiated walkout protests. You know, he's saying that they are providing the NPA renewed ranks, allowing institutions to be kind of like breeding grounds of terrorists. But then no university administrator has ever really echoed these calls and walkouts, right? These are generally initiated by students.
Yes, these academic walkout calls are initiated by students, student councils, student governments as part of our democratic right to participate in politics, to dissent, and to assemble, no? Especially in these different protests and electoral watch activities happening in NCR and even across the country.
Mm-hmm. But then, Jonas, Esperon has also since claimed that the communist movement deceived student activists into thinking their goal was to topple the Marcos dictatorship when their real goal was to seize power. Now, these are his words. What's your reaction to this?
Ms. Nikki, I think this, I would like to reiterate, and I think I would represent my fellow students, no? And I would like to reiterate that this is a baseless accusation. Even without walkouts, just because of our academic freedom and critical analysis of our political situation, this is kind of red tagging has always been there. Esperon and his cohorts have always targeted universities like University of the Philippines and other universities across Manila in order to discourage social discourse. So me, myself, I'm a victim of red tagging. And I reiterate also as representative of the whole UP Diliman community, and also I could also speak on behalf of the different student councils and our fellow students and youth, members of the youth, I would like to reiterate that these walkouts are within the bounds of our constitution, as well as this is our goal, is to protest against electoral fraud and oppose the Marcos presidency. Mm-hmm. And I would like to emphasize also that we are not armed. We are not members of the revolutionary organization, CPP, NPA, NDF. We're just fighting for our constitutional rights. Constitutional rights to amplify our calls, amplify the calls that this is a threat to the democratic rights of our society or our community or the Filipino people in general. Mm-hmm. So I would like also to say that NPE recruitment happens because people, especially in the countryside, are discontented with the government's public services. Hmm. And there will be an NPE recruiter. It's not the universities nor the student councils. Marcos and him not recognizing the atrocities of the martial law and these perpetrators of the different human rights violations. These are the true recruiters of these organizations. So they will be the greatest recruiters of the state's enemy.
And Cara, what do you say to Esperon's accusations that you have no respect for voters? That quote, by questioning the conduct and integrity of the polls, you believe you are the only ones who can think and other people do not have the right to.
I think that in the first place, students and a large majority of the demographic of voters in this election are first-time voters, student youth in general. And so we also have the right to manifest how we feel about these elections, whether it be through protests, whether it be through joining different electoral watch activities. So there is also that right that we practice as voters, that we practice as Filipinos. And I think that if we are questioning the integrity of the polls, many election watchdogs in this in the community, in civil society, have also called that this is a disenfranchisement of voters. And during the calls to extend the voting hours, during the numerous reports of vote counting machine malfunctions, SD card malfunctions, and election violence, no, especially in the in Barm region. So I think that at the very end of the day, like Secretary Esperon has to also recognize our right as voters, our right as a majority of the registered voters in this election to also manifest our dissent and to participate in politics and participate in our democratic process of elections in any way that we see it fit.
And Jonas, let's go back to the red tagging topic. In a separate statement, Communist Party of the Philippines Public Information Officer Marco Valbuena said it's officials like Esperon, on the other hand, who are pushing the youth to actually join the armed insurgency. Do you agree with this statement?
Actually, this is a very evident question. The reason why people join these kinds of organizations or in progressive organizations in general, because they're recognizing that there is a flaw in the system. There is something wrong in the platforms or in the campaign, or there is something wrong in the projects or the implementations of the policies in the government. I think in general, the different students, the different members of the youth, or the members of, not in the Communist Party of the Philippines, no, not joining them, but joining progressive organizations to understand more about the society, to understand more about the campaigns of the masses. And also, I would like to reiterate that this is also legal to join different protests, different walkouts, and different assemblies to protect. These are also protected by the Constitution. So I think in this statement, I would like to reiterate my statement that the atrocities of martial law or the atrocities of this government or the flawed system will be the greatest recruiters of this organization, tagged as terrorist, quote-unquote, organizations.
And Cara, do you think democracy in the country has weakened, even when Marcos is poised to be our first majority president in many years?
I think that the Marcos, no, returning to Malacanang, is the result of multiple structures, multiple different networks, institutions in our democracy that are contributing to it being weakened. When we talk about the oligarchs, no, political dynasty system, it has existed for so many years in the Philippines, but it's also this system that allowed Marcos to consolidate votes, no, in different parts of the Philippines, that also contribute to it being weakened. we look at the coordinated attacks, a seeding of trolls and coordinated inauthentic behavior that was seeded as early as the 2010s to manipulate how people see history, to manipulate how people view the Marcoses, and we are seeing the results of that now in the 2022 elections. It's a whole network, it's a whole system, ecosystem of very coordinated attacks, very coordinated structures that lead to it being weakened. So we have to view the Marcos, the presumed Marcos win as a result of, let's say, social media platforms not being regulated in that certain way. We have to look at it in the existence of political dynasties, them being able to consolidate power. We have to look as well into electoral fraud, the whole patronage politics that allows barangay voters on the very local level to, you know, to have their votes bought, to them being intimidated by barangay captains or other groups on the local level. So it really comes down to this being a majority, the first majority president in the Philippines. We have to look at it as a result of so many different things in the Philippine political ecosystem that led to this outcome.
And Jonas, what do you expect from a Marcos Duterte presidency as early as now in terms of red tagging and quote, I'm quoting the Human Rights Group and the UN here, institutionalizing the practice of stifling dissent?
This is very dangerous, Ms. Nikki. This is very, very dangerous. I think for the youth, we can see no future, basically. That's why we are protesting outside. That's why we are going out the streets, sacrificing also our academics, just to protest, just to amplify the cause of the people, because we believe that we have no future under the Marcos Duterte regime. We have seen 6 years under the Duterte administration. We have also more than 20 years under the Marcos dictatorship, and we don't want that to happen right now, because the next 6 years, me, myself, and also I think Kyra will be able to graduate. We'll have our own families. We have all, we will be having our own jobs. We'll be having our own lives. You know? But under different circumstances, no platforms for education sector, no platforms for the different campaigns of the masses, for the farmers, for the workers. No, I think we won't have future. Also, in University of the Philippines, we also became a fortress for activists and victims of human rights violations. And under Duterte, UPDND Accord was abrogated. And right now, we are constantly fighting for the institutionalization of the UPDND Accord. And these abrogation allowing state intrusion in the university, military harassment, surveillance of progressive groups and community leaders and different progressive individuals. So how much more under Marcos Duterte administration? So that's why we are going, student leaders, progressive groups, different sectors, students are going out to the streets calling and protesting against this upcoming administration.
And lastly, for you, Kara, as students, what's your reaction to presumptive VP Sara Duterte possibly being appointed as deputy chief? I mean, what could this mean for how history on their fathers' legacies will be taught?
I think on the first point, no, we know what Sara Duterte's stances on education are, whether it's mandatory ROTC. The reason why we took out mandatory ROTC is because of the corruption and the abuse under that system. So we can expect it to come back in the basic education system. So we also saw her statement now talking about how she wants to instill patriotism, nationalism. She wants students to be advocates of peace and discipline in their communities. So if we follow her trend of supporting very militarized reactions to whether it's local governance, her history, her family's history of dealing with people who dissent, this is a very dangerous position for presumptive VP to be in, because it's directly handling the formation of students, it's directly handling how teachers are trained, determines how what the basic education curriculum is going to be like. So this is very very scary reality, no? But I think second, in terms of what it means for the history, not just of her fathers, but also of her ally, the Marcoses. We've already seen in the DepEd modules, no, that have gone viral, that have been reported over the pandemic on the inconsistencies with what has happened in Philippine history as we know now, or even like coordinated attacks against.
All right. On that note, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you so much again for being here with us this morning, Jonas, Kara. You stay safe.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.